Okay, 12:35 tonight in Channel 4's Cinema South Asia season begins with the network premiere of Ball. Taking us there is something that redefined British urban music, their strong language from the start.
The doors were wide open, you know, everyone had their own angle on it.
For me, it was more of a vibe. You know, it was like a movement.
Yeah, we had our own thing going on. It was DIY. We built our own thing for ourselves, by ourselves.
It was a culture in itself. It was a family.
It was magic, you know. I don't think I realised it at the time. It was just the norm.
Tremendous. The Americans have hip-hop. They've got to be proud of that for the rest of their life. And we've got jungle drum and bass. We're proud of that, you know, till we die.
I don't think he's ever got the respect it deserves. Gary's come from drum and bass. So does dubstep. If jungle didn't exist, they wouldn't be existing.
Come on, bully. Come here. Right. This is where the history lesson begins.
Roll the bass.
53 Belgrade Road, this is where it all started.
This is the home of Shut Up and Dance music.
Breakbeat, hardcore. Drum and bass and jungle, it all started here.
1989, you know. Fucking hell, I haven't seen this record in years.
We took breakbeats and sped them up to like a dance tempo, which back then no one was doing.
That would have been like.
We had the sound system, Serlina, and then we changed it into the one and only Heatwave International. We had me, PJ, DJ Hype on the deck, my brother, Daddy Earl, on the mic as well.
We had all this, and for the age we were really cutting edge.
One of the main key sound systems was Soul to Soul. And I remember when they put out a tune and we was like, whoa, we've got to put out a tune.
Me and Earl were believing that they're going to fail so bad. Like, you know, I remember him playing me a tune and it weren't even in time. The beats, you know, it's like went out of sync. And it ended up selling, you know, 20, 30,000. What it done to me, it showed me, fuck what the industry says. It's out the back of a car and it's real. That generation locked into it so quick because it was real.
When we started playing acid house and stuff. And then at some point, breakbeat started to get involved in the house music.
I hear a lot of people talk about, you know, it started with house. And I'm like, to a point it did, but it started with this as well. I think it's the two things met in the middle. People like me bringing the breakbeat over, and then you had the house side, the two sort of combining.
When we started putting out stuff, it wasn't even for the rave scene. It was like, we're rappers. You can't play our stuff there. But then we checked it out, we went there, we heard them play our stuff. We was like, whoa, maybe it is a good thing.
That era onwards, every artist, you know, if they're breakbeat or jungle or anything with that kind of vibe in, if you talk to them about who was an early influence, it will sting back to them.
Chile pele pelang woi, woi, chile pele pelang woi, Ragga Twins, chile pele pelang woi, woi, chile pele pelang woi, Ragga Twins.
When it first started, it wasn't called jungle. It wasn't we came to Shut Up and Dance, made the music and it started, it was jungle. We didn't even have no name for it. After a while, we started going to raves and they'll play a tune and we'll chat lyrics and it would get wheel up or pull up. When we told the selector to pull up the tune one time, he's still playing the tune. We're like, pull up the tune. He's like, what do you mean pull up the tune? We're like, play it again from the top. He's like, what? Rewind it, rewind. So that's how we brought our influence of reggae over to the dance.
You had rave music. It was using all this ragga and reggae. So it was drawing people into the rave scene because of all the different sounds.
This one better than the Triller in Manila.
I think it was Paul Ibiza came out with a tune, it said Jungle on it. There was a few people that wasn't with it, you know what I mean? Because at the time, there was a lot of racism. Black people were called jungle bunnies and it was going to be a stereotypical thing and everything. But the name stuck, and the good thing about the name that stuck, when it said Jungle, when they checked it out, it wasn't just black people in the dance. It was a mixture of cultures, every culture together to be in one place. And that's what Jungle done. Over the world, you feel utter from afar.
Before Jungle, I mean, I was a house DJ. Labyrinth was where I started to test out the early Jungle stuff, you know, and it worked.
It was a massive, like, reggae hub, to be honest with you. It weren't rave. There was little things going on all over the place. This would have been the entrance here, with two double doors either side, and it would go right the way back, I mean right the way back. I wonder how many people have got a tower block named after their nightclub. I don't know if it's a good thing or a bad thing, or I should be laughing or crying.
It'd all been sort of a mixed melting pot up until that point. Not jungle, but hardcore, where you'd have a bit of techno, a bit of house, a bit of breakbeat, a bit of Euro, and it was all mushed in. And then what happened is by 92 now, all that's disappearing, and you've got all these experimental tunes. These are people using their ingenuity and they're just their imagination in little flats all around London.
Then all of a sudden, virtually overnight, you had people like Kenny Ken, you had people like Adrian Age turning up with tunes that no one else had. No one else had heard those tunes.
Labyrinth was a big part of the early days of Jungle, definitely.
As jungle and hardcore each really started getting momentum, there was a split, and I think jungle represented a really serious edge.
There was more in the jungle for people to follow, like vocals, the bass lines were totally different, they was more reggae orientated. The whole concept of jungle was just a whole new ball game, but people took to it, you know, it got big quick. Next thing you know, everyone wants to be a junglist.
I don't think it really mattered what was in those clubs before. This is a whole new thing. Boom. It just exploded.
It was crazy. I remember when it all happened, it just blew up. It was great because you'd walk down the street, you know, the cars driving past, we playing jungle. People have jungle stickers, you know, Cool London stickers on their window screen, their cars. It was a movement, and you could physically feel it.
It kind of fused everything.
It was our punk movement.
The whole music scene got rearranged.
I think the most important rave I ever did at that time was probably Jungle Fever in... They'd done one in Coventry. This was the first time they took it out of London. You DJ'd up, looking down at the crowd, and I had a friend of mine, him tapping me on the shoulder, and he pointed at the crowd, and he's like, I've waited all my life for this. And I went, what do you mean? He goes, listen to the music. It's like all the music, all the melting pot of what we grew up on into one sound with an audience that is, no, don't matter, black, white, you know, like the whole culture, you know, the rave scene. It was ecstasy bringing everyone together. You know, I don't care what anyone says that it was. With the jungle scene, I wouldn't say no one was taking drugs, but I don't think the drugs, it was the actual music, you know, hearing that multicultural sound at an eerie, the timing was perfect.
That drew me to jungle as well, you know what I mean? Just seeing the way people dance to it. Couldn't really teach someone to dance the jungle, you just got that vibe and you moved your body whichever way you saw fit. People used to pick up on the way the bass is separate from the breaks. Some people would dance to the bass.
Some people follow the breaks.
So you got some people who are nice and slow, and then you got other people who are proper skanking out, you know?
Skanking out, you know, rocking out, and you're just letting go. The bass, the beat.
To me, jungle about bass. So you follow the bass.
Kind of do what you want.
You know, if you want to come and spin off your head and do whatever you want to do, who cares?
A lot of people that weren't into the music were just like, how do you dance to that?
You know, you dance in half step. Because people used to come out and be dancing kind of like full steam ahead and burn out after 10 minutes. They're like, nah, it's too
and
much.
Not looking very good in the process.
Not looking very good in the process.
The running man was a big move back then.
But then the way some of the girls, especially the girls, were skanking out to the jungle was just unbelievable. We had these girls called the Rago Twins, and like they dressed their own way. They always used to dress in camouflage gear. And then you had this other group dressing a different way. You know what I mean? There wasn't no styling, it's just how you felt.
A jungle club, you could wear what you want. You know, you could wear the Moschino and Armani and the iceberg jumpers and, you know, you could wear that if you wanted. Or then again, you could wear a tracksuit and, you know, dress to sweat it out.
I think influence from the Caribbean and Caribbean culture, you know, and reggae and dancehall and, like, that kind of vibe. The whole MCs toasting the tracks to, like, doing their own lyrics, basically being, you know, with some bravado. And I think the fashion was the same thing. It was just, like, you'd wear clothes to show people that, you know, you were about. Yeah, look at me, I'm in all in one mush, you know, like, doing all right.
You was connected by the clothes you wore, the identity you had.
Different radio stations had different jackets.
Cool London, we had our rave jacket, Desert Storm, Rose, Telepathy.
Yeah, we were wearing MA2 jackets. It was part of what was going on.
You felt proud to show people that I'm part of this. I used to wear mine with pride. That's my uniform.
Enter, auto trader, skibbity the supplier, Laguna, Toyota, MR2 Celica, Cavalier Caliti Bra, Astro of Fiesta, enter my space cruiser, dealing with your Mata, no Skoda, Strada, Honda, check, check, Mazda, Nova, no Corsa, Sierra or Frontera, could it be the Benz, could it be the Beamer, hyping up at their temperature, we ride, like a Jaguar, Lexus, Kawak Banga, but oh no, here we go, rocking with that Polo, Mondeo, Volvo, Alfa Romeo, 205, Peugeot, Corrado, Corrado, GTI, Uno, Alos on your Punto, I deal with the Mata. Deal with it proper. Jeez! Jungle was just there. I'd say it's about 1993 was the first time I really heard it. I had a mate come to my house who's actually cutting my hair. Let's see if we can get in here. Inside these, I'm not sure. Caution, site entrance. It was Valentine's. That's where everybody wanted to go, all my mates, the whole crew of us. Like, everybody wanted to go to this jungle rave. I didn't really know what it was, but I just kind of followed everybody and was like, all right, cool, let's just do it. That was the first time that I saw UK MCs, you know, really controlling the crowd. And after that rave, I was just like, yeah, I want to get into the scene. Now, within a year, I'd made my way to Cool FM. Any MC who's trying to come through within the scene, that was a place to kind of get yourself heard. It was before YouTube and things like that and all any internet stuff. So, you know, without that, I'm not sure where my career would have gone.
The major explosion in pirate radio activity in and around Hackney was in around 93. All the major stations came from this area, these blocks. You had Pulse, Eruption, Cool, Defection, Weekend Rush, Pure, Chilling. It was easy to get on the blocks. You never had to force entrance. There was always someone eager to let you up here. The majority of the people who did let you up here listened to the stations as well, so there was more than helpful. You'd bring an aerial up here, a radio transmitter, cables, linking equipment. This is a lift shaft where most of the pirates would store their equipment, so it made it hard for the authorities or the rig thieves from gaining access to the equipment.
You'd have your studio in, say, Clapton Park, and then you would link over to, say, Holly Street, which is the white block over there. But you would have a midpoint in between, so we used to come from there, go to that block over there, and then midpoint over to the white block over there.
Sounds of the Morning Glory, sounds of Cool with a K, the original information centre.
Cool back then for me was kind of, it stuck to more of the reggae influenced music, didn't it, and it pushed that more and more and more. The governor of Cool was a reggae sound system guy that's been into that sound since the 70s.
All the top guys was on call. Like, you had Brocky, Young Ed, SL, Ron.
There's no other station that did for jungle music what Call did. Eastman and Brocky and all the guys over there. It was the mouthpiece for the whole scene.
The days of pirate radios and of being in tower blocks is all gone now. So most of the stations now have all changed over. They're all internet stations.
The radio stations, very, 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 very important. They played the tune on dub plate. The DJs played it out in the clubs, and then we'd get it on promo. It was part of that circle, you know, and we were all in it. People would come in and they'd go and do the little record shop rounds.
You'd want to go to Black Market, you want to go to Music Power, you want to go to Unity, you want to go to Wire for Sound because you wanted to get the freshest tunes before anyone else.
Kept everybody on their toes.
And if you didn't get round them shops, then 200 test presses were gone.
Right, I'm going to go out today to this store at this time, the back here, try and catch the promo on over there. You know, it was absolutely everything.
Sometimes on a Thursday and Friday, people would be bringing in white labels, and as quick as they were coming in, they were going out.
Me, Hype and Andy C used to meet up every Thursday and we'd go record shopping, every Thursday.
It wasn't just about going in and buying the records.
It was the culture in itself. It was a family. You go to Black Market, all the DJs would be there.
It was a meeting point.
The record buyers would come in there, the up-and-coming DJs would come in there. We'd all talk to each other.
It's such a shame that everything's gone to digital, so, like, we don't hook up anymore.
Yeah.
Best days of my life. I miss them.
See, like, top-name DJs down there standing at the counter, like Brocky. I've seen Groove Rider in Wire for Sound and Fabio. When a jungle tune comes on, all the hands go up. Yeah, yeah. People just grab them.
I guess just being so young and being a girl as well, because it would just be pretty much full of big boys and drum and bass, but you'd sort of push past and be like, yeah, I want that one.
Saturday, we'd have 7, 8, 9, 10 people deep. It was like a rave in here.
Yeah, and back in the day, you could smoke in public buildings and the whole place was just a cloud of smoke, bro.
Yeah.
It was nuts, you know what I mean? So you can imagine, you know, people giving us 10s and we're giving them 20s back.
We were making music for the young people that young people understood. We were making the money. And the majors didn't have a fucking clue.
I mean, we were getting all the majors coming here. We were doing a lot of the A&R.
We were doing the A&R.
And they were getting paid.
Yeah.
And I was like, what the? And then they used to come in, oh, what's hot now? And I'm like, mate, you got 20 grand for me. Yeah.
Goldie got signed to London Records. With majors, what happens is, oh, they've got Goldie. Another label, oh, we've got to have our Goldie. And then they'll sign someone who's nothing like him.
Goldie was a massive part to do with moving this music on.
We didn't think that anybody could chart or make a proper success of themselves. We're big fish, but we're in a small pond. He stepped outside of that pond and went, you know, to the mainstream and said, you know, this is my underground shizzle. He received critical acclaim for what he did.
I remember Goldie putting out his album and it wasn't like full of pop hits. He'd put out what was his true sound.
Yeah, I guess like anything that goes from being really underground to becoming overground and ripped off, and you know, there was so much stuff even in the charts that it got very, very watered down.
About 96, 97, everyone was trying to make jungle tunes, and the formula had become tired by then. It had lost its essence. It wasn't a inner city music by then. People were making money out of it.
There was a lot of trouble started happening in UK raves, which was nothing to do with class. That was to do with drugs, you know. 88, 89, 90, you know, everyone's taking ecstasy and they're all loving each other. By 1996, they're all fucking taking cocaine and champagne. It's a recipe for disaster.
The actual scene went through a lot of hard time with just guys coming to the events that were just kind of sometimes just causing trouble.
You'd go out to certain clubs, and it's like you'd have to bring like a firm with you because people wouldn't behave themselves. The councils were getting involved and going, look, you know, we don't want these parties. So it was on the verge of just dying.
Jungle, we used to get negative press and all that, so certain people wanted to distance themselves from that. That's why drum and bass was brought into the into the fray.
A lot of people were taking the so-called black element out of the music.
Some of the producers that were making the music at the time just thought, you know what, let's take those reggae samples out, all that rare groovy kind of stuff, let's take that all out and just make it a bit more just raw drums and bass. And that's how you had the name change.
It changed when it had to change, because if it didn't change at that time, jungle wouldn't have lasted forever.
People could see what was going on and just didn't want the whole jungle scene just to die flat out.
When you have something going commercial, it didn't really matter because our scene, it went underground again. And that's how we survived, just going underground.
Started hearing the sort of metalhead sound, and I guess it was more moving into drum and bass.
Well, Goldie just dropped Timeless. He said, yeah, all right, I'm gonna like take this a little bit further, I'm gonna start a night. And then across the road there, Blue Note.
It was like you were inside a speaker. Everybody was just in their own world, just going like ballistic to the music.
It was a kind of dark time, and the music kind of summed up what was going on.
It's like this fierce ball of energy, and you'd be just hearing stuff like that's so futuristic, the sounds.
What happened with drum and bass at that time? It then became trendy. Goldie was this personality. He was like a rock star.
He was running with Robbie Williams.
Robbie Williams and Bjork and Spice Girls coming down. Oasis as well. All of a sudden, jungle, this music that was hated, had turned into something completely different.
It became cool.
It became cool, and it became too cool. There's one thing, this music doesn't always rub well with being too cool.
You'd spot people like, oh my God, Bjork's over there, or like Lady Miss Keir's over there, but you know, it's totally normal.
Even the likes, you know, David Bowie and...
Yeah, I used to see that Bowie at parties.
Yeah, David Bowie, man.
Sitting on the floor, like nodding his head, like he was vibes out, and I was like, that's David Bowie. Yeah, well, everybody wanted a piece.
It's nothing new, it's just a revolution. You know, jungle drum and bass came along, after that garage came along, after that two-step came along, after that, you know, they entered into grime and then dubstep. It's always evolving.
It's just a name. This whole music scene, it's like a tree with branches off the edge.
It's now got 25 years of a foundation. Yeah, it ain't going nowhere, you know. Power of the people is everything.
When jungle came, everybody came together. And that's power.
You felt like you was a part of it all, you know, you belonged.
Jungle's our thing. We export it from England to the world, and the world love it.
As long as, you know, the vibes are good, I don't want to go home. I want it to carry on all night, all day, weekender.
Say to anyone, like, now, like, sort of watching this, go online, Google it or whatever, and just check out the history, you know, go back to, like, 87, 88, 89, and you'll see for yourself, you'll hear the sounds, and you'll hear the change of music and how it's got to where it is now.
So you should learn your history with music. Go and check it out. Check it out, man. We'll take all day. We've got the sound.